Welcome to this beginner's guide to crypto. By no means, this video is meant to be as a comprehensive overview of all the stuff, but it will give you a solid foundation to navigate your crypto space more or less comfortably. So let's get straight into it. At the core of every cryptocurrency like Bitcoin, Ethereum, and many, many others, there lies blockchain technology. And what is it? Many people refer to it as a digital ledger. And if you're familiar with the term ledger, you just understand what it means and imagine it in a digital form. However, if you don't really know what a ledger means, let me try to explain it using an analogy. So imagine like a huge group chat, and there anybody can enter this group chat and start sending messages. However, once you send a message, it cannot be deleted or edited. And every message is just of this type. I'm Veronica. I'm sending 100 coins to Philip. I now have 120 coins left, and Philip now has 150 coins. Then next message somebody else sends, like Justin, and Justin sends, I am Justin, I send 100 coins to Max, I now have 0 coins, and Max has 100 coins. So what you end up having is just a chat history of people sending money to other people and updated account balances. And this history is permanent, it cannot be edited or deleted. So you can think of this chat history as actually the digital ledger of transactions that have happened. The key thing about blockchain is that these transactions are not just singular, they are not just processed as in this chat history, they are processed in blocks. And a block is just a specific size, like a chunk of information that contains a certain number of transactions. So all the blocks are just a bunch of transactions grouped together. And what's important is that the history, as you know, it is conceptual. Sequential. So this sequential history means that the blocks have a specific order of the transactions. They have the balances, they have the addresses, and everything in those blocks stays the way it initially was. So once a new batch of transactions is added, it gets processed into a block by miners, you might have heard of them, or validators, and they append that block to all the previous blocks. So then all new transactions are added to the next block, then a bunch of new transactions get appended to the block we just added, and so on. And the process goes on, and you kind of get a forever chain of history of transactions from the very inception of the blockchain. You can go straight into the next section, but if you understand this part, you will probably know more than 95% of people in the space. So if you're interested, stay tuned to get an understanding of a decentralized distributed network, because that's what blockchain is. So you probably are familiar with what centralized and decentralized means, and let me just draw it out. So this is not central, and everybody has to do this node. This is a centralized network. Everybody has to get the information from one central node. If this central node gets knocked out, it has all the information. So all the nodes that are connected to it are going to lose their power. So let's say if an Amazon server that hosts a website gets knocked out, nobody can access that website anymore. What you can have in a decentralized system is that you can have several nodes that contain the information, and maybe some other guys that are connected to it, like this. So this is a decentralized network. Every node has some part of information. So if, let's say, this node gets knocked out, these nodes lose the access to the information of all the other ones. I mean, this exact piece of information gets lost. However, this whole thing stays out there, and it does not really kind of matter too much for this information if the other chunk got knocked out. So what you can do and have instead is that you can have every node have the exact copy of information, and every node communicates with other ones peer-to-peer. So this is a decentralized distributed network. So the nodes all communicate with each other, and there is a peer-to-peer communication happening between them. If one node gets knocked out, it does not mean too big of a deal. As long as there is like at least one node standing with the information, it's gonna work. But everybody has a copy of information, so it doesn't matter if one of them goes offline. Being decentralized and distributed, blockchain has two properties. Firstly, security, because as you can understand, this is a very robust system, maybe not as efficient as just a database that has one copy of information, but it is very robust. And secondly, it becomes immutable. So if you just try to change something in your copy of the blockchain and try to convince everybody that this is the right copy, and you let's say you added extra zero in your copy of the blockchain to your balance, people are going to know, people are going to notice because there are so many other copies of the blockchain. Next up, we go to wallets to interact with the blockchain, send tokens, receive tokens, or do anything else. You will need a wallet. You can think of it as like your bank card. Every wallet has a public key that is like your card number or bank account number, and it has a private key that is like your PIN code of your card. So you can use the card number or the public key in this case to send tokens because you know the address of the person that you would like to send them. And if you have both the public key and the private key, that is the card number and the card PIN code, you can also use this card or use this wallet to spend the tokens. When you create a new cryptocurrency wallet, they usually give you a seed phrase, and that is what just developers came up with as a convenient way to remember your private key, because private keys are just random sequences of numbers and letters, and they're very long and difficult to remember and to type as well. You can instead record 12 or 24 words, depends on the wallet, and use these words to log in to your account. So you can think of the seed phrase as your PIN code as well. And you can actually get your private key by hashing your seed phrase, but there is something for another video that's above the beginner level, I would say. So maybe at some point later, we can talk about that. Basically, the bottom line is wallets are just containers of your private and public keys. They allow you to interact with the blockchain, and they actually do not store your tokens. They just monitor the blockchain history of your account balance. Your tokens are stored on the blockchain, and wallets just allow you to interact with the blockchain. They are not like actual wallets. However, it's easier to think of them as like bank cards and so on. And speaking of bank cards, some cryptocurrency wallets even look like bank cards, and that is a type called cold wallets. Some cold wallets indeed look like bank cards, some look like USB sticks, some look differently like a tiny iPod or something, but mostly like card type and USB type. These cold wallets are called cold wallets because they do not connect to the internet. They're also called hardware wallets because they have their own piece of hardware that represents the wallet. The opposite type of these cold wallets are the hot wallets, and they are more popular and more convenient, but are considered less secure, and they can be just as a browser extension, as an application for your phone or for your desktop or laptop or whatever. What's important is that every network has a specific wallet for it. So Bitcoin network can only have Bitcoin wallets. Ethereum network has Ethereum wallets, or EVM wallets, they're also called. So if you want to send Bitcoin to somebody else, you have to use their Bitcoin wallet. And if you send it to somebody else's Ethereum wallet, your Bitcoin will be lost. So here is an example of the type of Bitcoin wallets. They look like this. It's just a random one. And this is the type of an Ethereum wallet. So all Ethereum wallets, all EVM wallets, usually start with 0x and then the sequence of numbers. What's important about Ethereum wallets is that there are many projects that have their own tokens. So the extra tokens apart from Bitcoin and Ethereum, but they're built on top of Ethereum. So this interesting concoction makes it possible to send those type of tokens that are built on top of Ethereum blockchain to an Ethereum wallet. So if a project is built on top of Ethereum and it's built its token and deployed its token on Ethereum, you can send this token to an Ethereum address. So for example, if we go to crypto.com and go to categories of Ethereum ecosystem, and there are tokens like USDT on Ethereum, there is a token of Arbitrum, this all can be sent to Ethereum addresses as well. But you usually have to check, for example, there is a Tron chain and it has a specific type of address. There is a Solana network that has specific wallet addresses, and any type of cryptocurrency usually has to be sent to a specific type of wallet. So now we kind of understand more or less how blockchain and cryptocurrency works and how to interact with it. you need to get your first hands on your first crypto. And how do you do that? You do that via exchanges. Exchanges are what allows you to trade, buy, and sell cryptocurrency. Those can be of two types. Centralized exchanges are just like your stock market trading applications. To register for a centralized exchange, you usually need to provide your personal information and go through the process of Know Your Customer, also known as KYC. So in there, you often provide your passport, your driving license, any kind of a lot of information about yourself, basically. And then they know about you, who you are, and they allow you to trade. The second type of exchanges are decentralized exchanges. They are built on top of the blockchain. And to do any kind of trading on a decentralized exchange, you don't need to provide any personal information there. All you need is a wallet. The caveat here is if you want to bring your bank account money, your fiat money, like rupees, dollars, or euros, if you want to bring that into crypto, you usually need to use a centralized exchange. It would be pretty difficult to do on a decentralized exchange. But before choosing an exchange, consider a user interface, how convenient it is to use. Different exchanges have different fees, and also supported currencies are pretty different. And the most important part, of course, to consider is in what jurisdiction they work, because certain exchanges work in certain countries only and certain are international. And now let's go to the next part, being airdrops. There, because buying is not the only way to get your hands on some cryptocurrency. Airdrops are just a way to get free tokens from projects that literally drop tokens to your wallets. And they do that either for because you hold some other token. So let's say you supported this token and you hold this, and therefore we'll airdrop you some other one because we're partners. Or for participation in some activities for the project. Let's say you retweeted many tweets, you are very active on their Discord, you joined their Telegram, and so on. Sometimes projects can tell you what they want you to do in order to qualify for an airdrop so that they would give you the tokens. But oftentimes they do not even tell you that there is going to be an airdrop, and they just expect you to be active in the project. And then they figure out certain criteria by which they would like to give tokens to some people. And then they airdrop these tokens to people. The main goal of airdrops is to firstly distribute tokens to in a decentralized way, because that makes sure that many people can get their hands on some tokens and they're not concentrated in the hands of some few rich people who can just buy them off exchanges or something like that. It's also a way to raise awareness of the project and also get some positive feedback from the community, because they're practically giving free crypto, which is what people want. However, be mindful whenever participating in airdrops, because some of them may be scammy and they can try to just steal your personal information or steal your funds from your wallet. So be careful what you connect your wallets to. One of the common ways to qualify for an airdrop is by participating in a testnet. Testnet is just a short term for test network. That is basically for developers to test out new features before rolling them out to the broad main network to make sure everything runs smoothly and so on. Testnets usually mimic the functionality of the main network, but they use valueless tokens and it costs nothing to participate in the testnet, usually, but not always. And then afterwards, projects try to reward you and thank you for helping them to test out the project, and they give you some mainnet tokens. Up until now, we have been talking about tokens a lot, and all we've been talking about are fungible tokens. Fungible means one token means it's interchangeable with the other. So if I exchange one ether, doesn't really matter which one I got. One ether equals one ether in value. NFTs, which are non-fungible tokens, are different from these fungible tokens in a way that each token is slightly different from the other, or really different from the other. It really depends. So the idea is that you cannot just swap one NFT for another because they do not hold the same values, properties, or price. NFTs are used to represent the ownership of some kind of asset. So that can be some kind of artwork, JPEG, any kind of simple thing. Or it can be something very serious, like a tokenized real-world asset. That is something that has been quite booming lately. But the idea is that with this NFT thing, you can prove that you are the owner of that exact thing. Because it's very difficult to do in the digital world because you can just copy and paste. But thanks to blockchain technology and NFTs, you can also prove now that you are the original owner of this particular thing. And it was not just copy and pasted. People usually buy NFTs with the hope of flipping them, that is, selling them again for a profit, so for a more expensive price. And this trading can be done on special NFT exchanges, and the popular ones are OpenSea and Blur, and they mostly sell just people putting out their artwork onto blockchain. So NFTs are like a particular narrative or a niche in the Web3 space. And you can think of this whole sphere of crypto being divided into spaces or niches, each with their own specific applications and technologies. And to explain this further, I'll just give you some big examples of niches. I have my notes out here because I'll literally forget which ones I wanted to mention. So for main one is obviously DeFi. DeFi aims to create an open financial system. So it's like a bank on blockchain. And the applications for that are like lending, borrowing, and yield farming. The backbone, the core of all this thing is a layer one blockchains. They can also be used as money, and Bitcoin and Ethereum are the prime examples of layer ones. Another big niche are layer twos. Layer twos are built as a supplement to layer ones to add some extra functionality or to address some of the inefficiencies that layer one blockchains have. Layer twos usually have some trade-offs in one aspect. However, they prioritize transaction speeds. Examples of layer twos are Optimism and Arbitrum, which are used as scaling solutions for Ethereum, that is to increase the throughput of the blockchain that would allow for Ethereum to be used more efficiently and for more dApps, more applications to be built on top of Ethereum by using those layer twos. The next narrative I would like to mention is a zero-knowledge technology, or ZK, it's also known as. The applications using the ZK are basically omnipresent in all the previous spheres I talked about. So L1s, L2s, and DeFi, they all have some kind of applications that use zero-knowledge technology. And what it allows you to do is basically prove that certain information is true without actually revealing that particular piece of information. The next niche I would like to mention is decentralized social media, or SocialFi, as some people also call it. And this is just the idea of the whole creator economy of Web3, where people can write their or publish their content, interact with others' people's content, but they also own their own content. So let's say when I publish this video, I will give up my rights to YouTube to own this video. However, in this decentralized social media, I would still be the owner of this video if I upload it on some Web3 crypto YouTube, so to say. Another big one, and the last one I would like to mention, but there are many more, is GameFi. GameFi is basically taking traditional games, bringing in DeFi into them, and bringing in NFTs into them, and combining this whole into a concoction. Games on blockchain, or using blockchain for some purposes, they can be either really good or really bad. So it's really a hit or miss with them. But indeed, this is a big niche as well. And that's kind of all I have for you in this video. Of course, don't take it as financial advice. This is just research I've done. If you want me to dive into any of the topics I mentioned a bit deeper in the future videos, please drop your suggestions in the comments. And thank you very much for watching, and see you in the next one.